Good evening. It's great to see all of you, and I always love to watch Judith graphically illustrate how important the state courts are as opposed to our quite wonderful federal courts that represent such a small part of what goes on in courthouses around the country. Let me start off by giving you my views as to what the purpose that courts serve today in our society, and then segue into an issue that I think is the greatest threat to the legitimacy of our courts and our system of justice. To me, courts today, and particularly the state courts, are the emergency room for society's ailments and illnesses, whether it be eviction, foreclosure, drug crime, family dysfunction, consumer credit cases, domestic violence, human trafficking, and so much more. This is particularly so in the state courts, where, as Judith indicated so clearly, 98% of the litigation, the cases in our country, are in the state courts and not in the federal courts that much of what we read about and know about seems to tell us that that's where people come into contact with the justice system, but it's just not the case. The average person comes into some kind of relationship with this concept of justice in our state courts. And it's the one place that anyone, rich, poor, or in between, should be able to get what we call equal justice, where everyone is treated the same with a neutral arbiter of your dispute. This is embedded, that concept of equal justice is embedded in our laws and in our founding principles. Yet today, in our country, there is a huge justice gap between the finite legal resources available and the desperate need for legal services by the poor, by the vulnerable, by people of modest means. This justice gap limits access to the courts and access to justice, where the rich can afford the best legal representation you can possibly imagine, and the poor and people of limited means cannot afford a lawyer at all. How does this happen? How has this been allowed to happen? First of all, in certainly these last years, the economic problems that we've had has led so many people to literally fall off the cliff and destroy themselves and their families. The funding for legal services, for lawyers that can help poor people and people of modest means, has been reduced in Washington. The Legal Services Corporation, which is the primary federal funder of legal services for the poor, has been cut and continues at a very limited level. IOLTA funds, which are the interest from lawyers' accounts, escrow accounts, that they hold for their clients, the interest on those monies go to help fund legal services for the poor. They've been drastically reduced because of the poor economy. And the heart of the problem, what I'm talking about now, is civil legal services for the poor, as distinguished from criminal legal services. When someone's liberty is at stake, there is a constitutional right in the United States to be represented. We all know that. We all know about Gideon's trumpet, the famous case of Gideon versus Wainwright, when the United States Supreme Court said, when you are in danger of having your liberty taken away from you, you're entitled to a lawyer. That's not the case in civil matters. You may be fighting for the necessities of life, the roof over your head, your personal safety, the well-being of your family, your livelihood. you are not entitled to a lawyer in the United States of America. And while Gideon, well, we go Gideon versus Wainwright, this just seminal case of the United States Supreme Court has not resulted in a perfect system, and you're going to hear a little bit about more about that today. It's very uneven. At least there's a constitutional flaw. Everyone is entitled to a lawyer. Yet, to give you an example, in New York, during this terrible economic crisis, or really the worst of it, 8 of 9 people that came to the Legal Aid Society in New York City, the oldest legal services entity in the United States, were turned away because there weren't enough resources for the Legal Aid Society to represent them. 2.3 million people last year are estimated to come into the New York State courts without legal representation. What could undermine the justice system more than this lack of a level playing field for the rich and for those of limited means? If we can't ensure equal justice, then even in this vast state court system, which in so many ways, again, is the one place where we hold out that hope, all of us, no matter what our station in life, for justice, this abstract term that we want to make more concrete, if we can't ensure equal justice, we might as well close the courthouse doors. They really don't mean anything. Our system of justice, our system of government would be so lacking. So what do we do about it? What we're trying to do is reprioritize the things that are important, that are essential in society. And we believe in the courts, judges, lawyers, those of us who support the court system as this bastion of equal justice, that legal representation for those who cannot afford a lawyer is as important to our society as housing and hospitals and schools. It's every bit as important. And because we don't say that, it's the economy is bad this year, let's not have schools for our children, or let's not have hospitals to tend to our sick. We can't say that. And we believe that it's equally important to say that you can't be in a situation, the economy's bad, we can't help people have legal representation, even when it involves the essentials of life. And to get there, to get to this reprioritization, we have to educate and we have to advocate for legal services for the poor. What we've done in New York is set public hearings around the state to have the public understand what legal services do for people in need. We don't just have people come in and say, it's a good thing to help poor people. That's the right thing to do. They need lawyers. Let's help them. I have to tell you, it doesn't work. But what we've done is, in a counterintuitive way, we have the heads of the largest businesses, the landlords, the real estate industry, the heads of our hospitals, the business people, and people who you wouldn't expect to be concerned about legal services for the poor, come in and say that this is the best investment that society can make. That for every dollar invested in legal services for the poor, $5 to $6 are returned to the state in reduced incarceration costs, reduced social services costs, more federal funding coming to New York. And in trying to get this message across, I think that judicial leadership is very, very important. It is the constitutional mission of the judiciary to foster equal justice. If not us, who? If the judiciary and the profession are not going to stand up for people in need of legal services, no one will. And that's why we put this last year $70 million in the judiciary budget in New York to give out grants to legal services organizations. This is compared, to give you some sense of context, in the entire United States, the Legal Services Corporation gets $360 million to give out among the 50 states. And we do it because it's not tangential to who we are. It is fundamental to the judiciary's role. We have to show that we stand for something. And the bottom line is that by the judiciary supporting legal services as basic to its mission, we say once and for all that equal justice is the one thing that matters in what the courts do. But with all of that, there's not enough money in the world to support the need of people who need civil legal services. So what we need also is the voluntary pro bono efforts of the bar to give of their time for free to help people, again, fight for the essentials of life. This is a noble profession. You hear about all the lawyer jokes. We think being a lawyer is a noble thing. That is really, from time immemorial, lawyers help people. That's what we do. And it's not enough. We have a monopoly on legal services. It's not enough to use that monopoly to feather our own nest, to serve our own economic interest. We have to give back. We have to help people in need. That's what lawyers are supposed to do. And the judiciary, as the legal regulator of the profession and as the gatekeeper for bar admission, should be leading the way, pushing the envelope for having lawyers aspire to the highest principles of our profession and not to the only to their own economic interests. So our job is to promote public trust and confidence. Lawyers serving other people promotes that public trust. And that's why in New York and around the country, we're reaching out to lawyers, to constituencies that we've never had doing enough pro bono work. Baby boomers who are starting to slow down their practices should be now doing voluntary pro bono work for the poor. Aspiring law students who now we require in New York to give 50 hours of pro bono work, free legal services to the poor before they can be admitted to the bar, with the theory being that if you want to be a lawyer in our state, you have to embrace the core values of our profession, which is those values are first and foremost service to others. That's why we have a pro bono scholars program that lets law students take the bar early if they'll give their last term over to pro bono work. That's why we require lawyers to report their pro bono work to the courts to let us know how we're doing. So the bottom line is there's lots of things going on in the area of promoting equal justice, in promoting access to the courts. It includes public funding, it includes pro bono work, it includes new ideas like having non-lawyers help in the process of promoting equal justice. So where does all this go? I think where it goes is that we are changing the public dialogue. If you asked years ago, do you think before Gideon versus Wainwright, do you think someone whose liberty at stake needs a lawyer? People would say maybe. Today, everyone would say definitely. We want to get to the point when you ask today, the people need a lawyer, if the essentials of life are at stake, we want everyone to say, yeah, absolutely. So the bottom line is we want to make the ideal of equal justice a reality. We think that the judiciary, the profession, have a major role in this effort. And we think it's a partnership between the profession, the judiciary, and academia. And we think by continuing to do new and interesting things, we can change that dialogue. We can get to the day when there is, similar to the criminal right to representation, there's a right to representation for everyone who is seeking the fundamentals that we all have in life. So, thank you.